In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Welcome to the Holy Souls Chapel here at St. Aloysius' Church in Glasgow. It's the 33rd Sunday of the year. We approach the ending of the church year in a couple of weeks. So we pause, we place our hearts before God, conscious of God's love, and we ask the Spirit of God to move gently through our hearts, forgiving, healing, giving strength and courage. You were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
And you are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
And may Almighty God have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. Lord our God, grant us the constant gladness of being devoted to you, for it is full and lasting happiness to serve the author of all that is good. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
A reading is from the book of Proverbs. A perfect wife, who can find her? She is far beyond the price of pearls. Her husband's heart has confidence in her. From her, he will derive no little profit. Advantage and not hurt, she brings him all the days of her life. She is always busy with wool and with flax. She does her work with eager hands. She sets her hands to the distaff. Her fingers grasp the spindle. She holds out her hand to the poor. She opens her arms to the needy. Charm is deceitful and beauty empty. The woman who is wise is the one who to praise. Give her a share in what her hands have worked for, and let her works tell her praises at the city gates. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be
to God. O blessed are those who fear the Lord.
O blessed are those who fear the Lord.
O blessed are those who fear the Lord and walk in his ways. By the labor of your hands you shall eat, you will be happy and prosper. Blessed are those who fear the Lord. Your wife will be like a fruitful vine in the heart of your house. Your children are like shoots of the olive around your table. Blessed are those who fear the Lord. Indeed, thus shall be blessed the one who fears the Lord. May the Lord bless you from Zion all the days of your life. O blessed are those who fear the Lord.
A reading from the first letter to the Thessalonians. You will not be expecting us to write anything to you about times and seasons, since you know very well that the day of the Lord is going to come like a thief in the night. It is when people are saying, "How quiet and peaceful it is," that the worst suddenly happens, as suddenly as labour pains come on a pregnant woman, and there will be no way for anybody to evade it. But it is not as if you live in the dark for that day to overtake you like a thief. No, you are all children of light and children of the day. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. We should not go on sleeping as everyone else does. but stay wide awake and sober. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia. 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 Even if you have to die, says the Lord, keep faithful and I will give you the crown of life. Alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus spoke this parable to his disciples. The kingdom of heaven is like a man on his way abroad who summoned his servants and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to a third 1, each in proportion to his ability. Then he set out. The man who had received the 5 talents promptly went and traded with them and made 5 more. The man who had received 2 made 2 more in the same way. But the man who had received 1 went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. Now, a long time after, the master of those servants came back and went through his accounts with them. The man who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more. Sir, he said, you entrusted me with 5 talents. Here are 5 more that I have made. His master said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You have shown you can be faithful in small things. I will trust you with greater. Come and join in your master's happiness. Next, the man who had 2 talents came forward. Sir, he said, you entrusted me with 2 talents. Here are 2 more that I have made. The master said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You have shown that you can be faithful in small things. I will trust you with greater. Come and join in your master's happiness. Last came forward the man who had 1 talent. Sir, he said, I had heard that you were a hard man, reaping where you had not sown and gathering where you had not scattered. So I was afraid, and I went off and hid your talent in the ground. Here it is. It was yours. You have it back. But his master answered him, you wicked and lazy servant. So you know that I reap where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered. Well then, you should have deposited my money with the bankers, and on my return I would have recovered my capital with interest. So now, take the talent from him. Give it to the man who had 5 talents. For to everyone who has will be given more, and he will have more than enough. But from those who have not, even what they have will be taken away. As for this good-for-nothing servant, throw him out into the dark where there will be weeping and grinding of teeth. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
When I was a young deacon, I was doing my training in South Africa, in Bramfontein, central Johannesburg, and there was a Jesuit who was the parish priest at that time. He was a loquacious man. So if I was the deacon and preaching at that particular mass, he was always happy to have me there. The problem was he didn't like not preaching. So what he would do is he would tend to, at the beginning of the Mass, at the beginning of the penitential rite, he would give more or less a 10-minute homily before Mass began, going through all of the various readings and taking all the various things so that then... So by the time it actually got to the place where the homily took place, he'd used all of the major themes and exposed them and that, so there was nothing much you can do. But I got wise to that, but also you got to get kind of a little bit sort of offbeat. So once I remember, just in that particular setting, thinking he's going to talk about this and he's going to talk about that. So one homily, I actually just preached on the Alleluia verse that day, knowing that he wouldn't go into that. He may go into the first, second reading and the Gospel, but he wouldn't go into the Alleluia verse, and he didn't. There's something of that when I was looking at today's readings. The Gospel is that fantastic Gospel in chapter 25, you know, the parable of the talents, we know it well. But also I thought to myself, we've had that quite recently, and even at some point I've been preaching on it. So I thought, well, not sure about that. First reading, Proverbs. Well, Proverbs was probably, those of you who are watching and celebrating with us, if you're married, you're likely to be talking about Proverbs reading even now. And so I'll leave that argument for husbands and wives and couples around. So I won't even touch on that one. But perhaps not quite the Alleluia verse, but it gives me a chance a little bit to reflect on that second reading to the Thessalonians. Let me say a little bit, because we're losing Thessalonians now as the year comes to a halt. One of the things with Paul's letters, the letters of the New Testament, is that, as one scripture scholar once said, it's like listening to half of a telephone conversation. You can hear what the person is saying on this side, but you don't know what's being said. And it is like that in Paul's letters. We know what he's writing, but we're not quite sure what he's responding to. And so we're trying to piece together from what he says what is going on in the church that he's writing to. And this is something equivalent to what we find now in this letter to the Thessalonians. And Paul is writing to the church at Thessalonica. Now, if you're like me, sometimes the words all mean different things. So Corinth and Thessalonica, they're all kind of towns, they're all cities, they all merge together as in one. But maybe it's a good opportunity to think a little bit about Paul's life and where these things fit in. Paul, very recently in this time, has come. He's come from Asia. He's one of the first people to have crossed over into Europe, northern Greece, preaching the word of God. And he preached, and first he went to Philippi. But there all sorts of things broke out, and he was eventually imprisoned. An earthquake loosened the bonds. But even from Philippi, he was asked to leave. So he went. And he eventually got to Thessalonica within a few days. Thessalonica was a fairly modern city. It had been built by one of the generals of Alexander the Great, who came from that area, Macedon. And that particular general had named it after his wife, so it became Thessalonica. And it was a trading place. It was a place where even now the Roman roads were leading to. It was a cultural mix. There were temples to the gods of Rome, temples to the gods of Greece, and even temples to the gods of Egypt that were there in Thessalonica. Now, although it's a one-sided telephone conversation that we get from Paul, we're helped in this case by St. Luke, because in the Acts of the Apostles, he, in his chapter 16 and 17, tells about this particular part. What would seem clear is that Paul arrived and entered into it. And although a multicultural community, there was also a synagogue there. And Luke says, on three Sabbath days, Paul went to the synagogue preaching the word of Jesus Christ to the Jews. And this seemed to go reasonably well, but then it all fell apart. Somebody in the community, somebody in the town, got a crowd to come up, and they came and they tried to break up the various Christian meetings that were there. So much so that Paul had to escape the city and then to move. And so he went down and he eventually got to Corinth. But Paul was worried. He was worried about the community that he'd left behind, one of the first communities, Christian communities in Europe, after Philippi and now Thessalonica. And he sent Timothy back from Corinth, and he went, sent Timothy back to go and check on the Corinthians. Were they still there? Had they been persecuted further? He was highly relieved when Timothy returned to give Paul the word that the community was still there. Things had happened, but they were still there and they were still worshipping. And it's this that stimulated Paul's letter to the church at Thessalonica. It's a letter which is different to a lot of his other letters. It's one that he moves on to different topics all the time. It's not systematic like the letter to the Romans, which is much later in Paul's corpus, where he's sitting down thinking about what he's trying to do. This one is he's writing it quickly, sending it off, wanting to get news to them, wanting to give instructions to them, this new basic community that he's set up. It's an interesting letter, but also it's an important letter, because this letter, 1 Thessalonians, is the first letter that was ever written and we have collected in this. It's the first document of the New Testament, and Paul never expected, I'm sure, that such a fragment of his writings would ever have been held, and yet there we have it, it's caught. And it's Paul expressing something of the Christian message within 15 years of the death of Jesus. And for that reason, it's such an important text. And it may be that you're trying to think about what to look at in the scriptures, but maybe to even just look at the opening, the beginning, the first 10 verses. If you have a Bible at home, to look at the first 10 verses of that first letter to the Thessalonians, to the people of Thessalonica. And in that first 10 verses, even though he's kind of writing with great relief of what is there, you can see already crystallizing is Paul's thought. It's a wonderful opening. He says, from Paul and Silas and Timothy to the people of Thessalonica. And he brings in, within these first 10 verses, some of the key threads that are already crystallizing in Paul's understanding of Christianity. He speaks of the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit, the Trinity already there. But also, he talks about the love, the hope, and the faith that is important in the lives of the people of Thessalonica. So as we ponder on this Sunday, and we perhaps sometimes just can glance over the readings that Paul gives, we catch a glimpse of another Christian community at a different time with its own problems and difficulties. We, in a time here where we are worried about things like COVID, worrying about health, worrying about finance and business and all of those things. And in some ways, we think it's unprecedented. We live our faith, and we would like to live it in a stable time. But Paul, in his own life, with the instability as he moves from city to city, and talking to a community that is grappling with the faith, not fully formed in it, and yet see it as something as their great salvation. So maybe we step back 2,000 years as we resonate with the church that is there. That same Holy Spirit, that same God the Father, that same Lord Jesus Christ is the core of our faith. And likewise, the core of our faith is with faith, hope, and love. As St. Paul would say in another letter, and the greatest of these is love. Let us ask these things to take root in our hearts as we pray and as we give our hearts to God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And so let us pray that this, our sacrifice, may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at our hands for the praise and the glory of God's name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. Amen. Grant, O Lord, we pray, that what we offer in the sight of your majesty may obtain for us the grace of being devoted to you and gain us the prize of everlasting happiness. We ask this prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let's lift up our hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
And let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live and move and have our being. And while in this body, we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Easter mystery. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. And once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. Mystery of faith. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and the blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of love, together with Francis our Pope, with Philip our Bishop, and with all the clergy and all the men, women and children who bring your good news into our world. Remember also our sisters and brothers who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Joseph and the Apostles, with St. Paul and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, that we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen.
In the words that Jesus gave us, let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all needless distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. As part of the Mass, we always pray for peace. And also in November, we remember those who have died. So November can be a time that of trauma, either because people have died recently or we are remembering those that we have lost. But we pray and place all of those who have died before the grace and the glory and the mercy of God, and we ask for peace in our hearts as we remember them. And if you know the peace prayer, please, at home, feel free to join me as I pray. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look then not on our sins, but on the faith of your Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign for ever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
We offer each other a sign of peace. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, grant us peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are we who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body and the blood of Christ bring us all to everlasting life.
Amen.
My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
And so let us pray. Father, we have shared with the gifts of this sacred mystery, humbly asking that what your Son commanded us to do in memory of him may bring us growth in faith, hope, and love. We ask this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless us all, Father, Son, Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Mass is ended. We go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks
be to God.
Thank you.